Okay, we were telling you that because I said I wanted to catch up on it, but I want to get to a topic I find particularly interesting because a lot of us are spending time on Zoom in meetings. I know I am, and if it's not Zoom, it's Teams, and if it's not Teams, it's Cisco WebEx, and so forth. And so are kids. And you know what? It's not easy for the kids because it's boring. You know, you've got a teacher in a little box on your screen who's talking away, and the kids can't really interact in a classroom-like way. But somebody who knows more about how you use video communication than most of us would, and he's a professor and a gamer, has figured this out. Dr. Christopher Alexander is a communication and design assistant professor who teaches video game design at Ryerson University. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Well, you're not Alexander. You are Alexander. You're not Anderson. And I don't know why I had that name in my head, but it doesn't matter. What matters is you're using Twitch. And anybody who's into esports and gaming knows what Twitch is. They know what Discord is. How are you integrating that into the classroom?
Excellent question. Thank you so much for having me. So what I'm doing is I'm using Twitch and a free piece of software called OBS to engage with participants beyond the screen. They can do that by interacting with me via text. So if they're chatting in the, let's say we're using Discord, for example, or they're chatting in whatever software we're using, like let's say it's those ones that you mentioned, Zoom, we can have their interactions appear on screen. The other thing I do to engage is I have different...
Can I just stop you there so that we can clarify? When you say chatting, there are a lot of people out there who think like what we're doing right now is chatting.
Ah, gotcha.
You mean the on-screen chat that is parallel to what's in the video window.
That's correct. So while you're watching on screen, you can type text, words, into the computer that can appear for somebody else to see. I'm able to put those up on screen so that students know that when they say something, everyone else can see it. They get highlighted as part of the instruction.
So they become part of what's going on as opposed to maybe texting each other on their phones behind everybody else's back. So if somebody is watching what you're saying and you're teaching or any teacher and they're using the chat window at the same time and say, what a goof, everybody gets to see it, including you.
That's correct. And it happens sometimes. Let's say I make a slip up. They'll make fun of me, but it's great. It's part of the engagement. They're watching to see if I make mistakes. They're watching for me to deliver some kind of captivating message, and they'll react with emojis and such on screen. So, yeah.
Have you had any conversations? You're with Ryerson, but I mean, have you had any conversations with the high school or elementary level people or those who are in charge of what is used? Because I think that the software that's being used in lower level pedagogical environments, so the high schools and the elementaries, it's pretty consistent stuff. They're not using gaming software or giving students the ability to interact that way. They're kind of teaching a concept, and then they might say, now Johnny, what do you think about this? Can you add this and this? And that's kind of one-to-one while a bunch of other people watch, oftentimes bored. Isn't that what you're trying to get around?
Well, yeah, it is what we're circumventing. Also, the platform I mentioned, OBS, is available on Mac and PC, and it's set up as an interactive tool to many camera softwares, including Zoom. So it's kind of platform agnostic. So that affords the ability to create different things. And back to your question about the school boards, my wife actually works for the TDSB. So her and I have been experimenting with these things. For example, sometimes when she's teaching, she's reading to students, she'll want to start making notes on a pad. So I showed her how to screen capture just a whiteboard, and she's writing. She switches to that while she's teaching, and she writes for the students live in real time. And she is teaching grades 1 to 8. So again, I think in most situations, it's about understanding that this technology is available. And in most cases, it's free.
Well, you're even using what you call partial green screens. Now, I, being in the broadcast industry, understand green screens. Most people out there don't know that the green screen is a green background that, say, the person who tells you the weather on television is using. They're not standing in front of that map. They're standing in front of a green screen and watching a monitor off to the side. But that's used for a reason. And the way you use it, it's because you can key out the green and put in anything you want. And that's what you're doing.
That's correct. I am doing that with my in-classroom presentation so that I'm inside of my PowerPoint presentations, as well as I have information that just appears as a lower third. Now, as a disclaimer, I went to school for broadcast technology, so the things that you're describing, like, I totally understand it. So I'm trying to find in ways to engage students with what they're used to seeing on your show, for example, on their favorite shows.
I have a green screen to get on radio here. Kidding you. No, I understand what you're saying, and I think people out there do. Look, if your kid is bored and in school virtually, which hopefully by next week no kid will be, mm-hmm. but one never knows, what is it as a parent, because that's who we're mostly talking to, that you tell your school board or tell your teacher they should do to get the kids more engaged?
Well, one thing is explain to them that there are different ways of engagement, but it might be a situation where we need our boards to start considering creating time, like time for teachers to be able to learn, time for people to reach out to people like me to, you know, it's not simple, but it is available. So I think people need to know that it exists, and then things can be put in place to start moving towards, if that is a goal.
Well, let's you and I hope one thing, that there are people who are as imaginative as you around, if God forbid we have to go back to virtual learning. And we both hope that we don't as things open up again, but you've been very careful and used your skills to take it a step beyond, and you've interacted with your kids in a much better way. Thank you for taking the time this morning.
Thank you. Take good care.
All right. That's Dr. Christopher Alexander. He's a communication and design assistant professor who teaches video game design at Ryerson University and is using that skill to make the interaction between people learning.